Kenka Bancho on the surface is somewhat similar to the Yakuza series, despite coming out 6 months earlier. It's a Japanese-style open-world beat-em-up with RPG elements and a focus on story. Not a huge focus, but still, it matters. Also like Yakuza, Kenka Bancho is very steeped in Japanese culture, in this case the Tsuppari and Yankee youth delinquency subcultures, which rose up in Japan in the 70s and 80s, reaching mainstream popularity with TV shows such as Bebop High School. Shows like that, as well as the popular Kunio-kun series of games by Technos Japan, inspired Tomoyuki Matsumoto, who after working on Fire Pro Wrestling in the 90s, got to make his own game. And working for the developer YSK and publisher Spike, that game was Kenka Bancho. The first game set up the rules for the series, and one of the most important rules is that to be a true man, you have to be cool. Being cool is called shibui. Being uncool is called shabai. Being shibui basically means you win fights. There are more ways to fail than succeed, and uncool or shabai things to do include running away, hitting random people, hitting women, using weapons, and losing or starting a fight without first going through the proper introduction, aka the Menchi Beam and the Tanka Battle. The Menchi Beam is an intimidating stare that manifests itself as a blue laser beam coming out of your eyes, sound effect and everything. Then when the person you're staring at stares back, you begin the Tanka Battle. Basically, you insult your opponent to gain the initiative. Then you can start fighting. If you screw up the Tanka Battle, you lose some cool points, but as long as you win the fight, it's not that big a deal. This applies to women too, because while you do lose coolness by hitting women, you gain them back again if you knock them out. Odd logic, to say the least. The first game, however, takes the Shabai Shibui thing very seriously, and once you get Shabai, it's not that easy to get back from it. It takes a lot of winning fights, or you can pay it off at the shrine for quite a hefty amount. But while you are considered uncool, you can't shop at the stores, which is a harsh punishment. The Tanka battles are fun if you understand them, but unless you are in fact Japanese, I really recommend playing all the games in the series on easy mode, because then the Tanka battle options are fewer, and you don't get punished as much for failing. The first three games have the same system. In 4 and 5 you pick a complete line at the start, and then complete it along a line like kind of a music rhythm game. Tokyo Battle Royale got back to the original system, only simplified, and 6 has QTEs more or less. Then you pick a complete line, which has an effect associated with it, like getting money, an item, or stunning the guy. The first three games has a fun twist, that there were secret combinations you could do other than the one that the game tells you to do. Also wrong combinations that elicit unique responses, and these can be positively hilarious, at least to me. Then the actual fight begins. This basic overview is carried throughout the series, with only minor button changes because it went to PSP later on. I call them attack buttons because you can decide yourself if they do punches or kicks, because Kenka Bancho has a combo creation system. The super attack uses Kiai, which is basically like the heat from the Yakuza series, except it increases as you get beaten, not when you beat others. You can also recharge it by going home and sleeping, or by sitting down, unko suari as it's called, shitting stance. You can do this at any time while out and about by pressing X and circle, or R3, and it even works during battles, but of course you might not get to sit for very long. After fights you get experience, even though the game doesn't announce it until you've leveled up. In the first game it's your Bancho degree. From 2 and on it's your Otoko no Utsua, your male instrument. Not that one. Then you get Tamashi, or spirit points, that you can allocate to a number of areas. They vary somewhat along the series, but basically it's strength, HP, Ki, lung capacity, constitution, speed, and in the fifth game, luck. Lung capacity dictates how long you can run before having to stop for air, but it also acts up during fights, which can be quite annoying, having to stop for air in the middle of a brawl. Another related thing here is that the first three games has both a health bar and a stamina bar. You primarily lose health when you get hit, of course, but in time also stamina. You can't recover health with items beyond the reach of the stamina bar, so if your stamina gets low, you really have to go back home to sleep to max it back up. You can also stand still and regain your health up to the max reach of the stamina bar, which is nice to know, but still, it takes a while. Should you get your ass kicked, Kenka Bancho 1 acts like an RPG, and you have no choice but to reload a saved game. But from the second game on, you can continue as much as you want, but with punishments. You go to the hospital GTA style, only you come back with bandages, and in some of the games you lose whatever clothes you had on. In 5, you come back wearing pajamas. For me personally, I just restart the game if I die. It's less humiliating that way. And cheaper too. And when you get arrested, you come back in the Japanese equivalent of a prison jumpsuit. Speaking of clothes, in the whole series you can buy them, and for more categories than usual in games. Actually, this level of clothing options I've only seen in Saints Row before. One quirk that this brought with it, in the first few games at least, was the amount of pockets. It would depend on the clothing items. Since items can be crucial to survival, this limits your options somewhat, did for me at least. Luckily they got rid of this system by the fourth game. The fighting in these games is generally pretty fun, but it can also be frustrating. The enemies can be relentless, you get stunned and dizzy, allowing them to take advantage, sort of forcing you to use the super attacks to get them off your back. In the fifth game, the screen clouds up as you take damage, then you can do a tanka to get into a kind of revenge mode. But it's not cathartic, just annoying to have to do. The first two games start out pretty hard, since you have a short life bar and can't carry many items, leading you to have to run home to sleep a lot. But overall, it is fun. So what about the story? Well, the Kenka Bancho series is not up to the Yakuza level of mature storytelling, but they did give it a shot. Occasionally. The first game is pretty simple. You play as Yasuko Tanaka, who is the leader of the delinquents, or Bancho, at his school. And at first he goes on a kind of tour of neighboring schools to challenge them and become the strongest. But eventually a dangerous gang emerges with ambitions on the whole town, and Tanaka and his new friends band together to defend themselves. The story itself is nothing to write home about, but the presentation with the narrator and the individual scenes of rivalry and friendship and so on gives it a certain charm, and I was interested in seeing what would happen. The series would reach its pinnacle in the story department with the sequel, Kenka Bancho Full Throttle, released also on the PS2 in 2007. It takes place in the same town, and Yasuo Tanaka is still here, except you don't play as him, but as a younger kid, who wants to go by the name the Rabbit Dog, but at first everyone calls him Pooch. He looks up to Tanaka as the big bad Bancho, while at the same time lamenting how his best friend from junior high, Ryo, turned out, having become a grey-haired villainous leader of a biker gang, who also have ambitions of taking over the town. What's really nice about this game is that the story branches depending on your actions, and they don't feel super telegraphed either. But basically you can turn evil and join Ryo, or stay good and loyal to Tanaka. However, you only get the full story really if you do turn evil, and it's Ryo that has the character development. The only game in the series with a truly interesting villain. Sure, the original game also had a story branch where you can either save Hachiya or have him die, but it doesn't change very much. It's done better here. Kenka Bancho 2 is also the only game in the series with an open world. Sure, it's not as open as GTA, since you can't walk up hills or walk in forests, etc. But instead of the previous game's areas that were separated by loading screens, they're all connected here. Because of the open world, this is the only game in the series with a clock, and some events can only be done at certain times, but they're not missable as far as I know. The other major addition to the sequel is what the subtitle alludes to, motorcycles. You start out with a simple bicycle, but you can get a license and start driving proper bikes. Unfortunately, there's really no point in doing this, because YSK thought it would be necessary to add all the rules of the road to the game. So while you can get on a bike, it's also extremely easy to break traffic laws, which cause you to eventually get chased by the cops, get knocked off like you weigh nothing, and when you get arrested, you lose your license for something like 2 months of in-game time. Luckily though, there are no missions that force you to use the bikes, but I still wonder why they added something cool, only to ruin it so completely. With Kenka Bancho 3 Zenkoku Seiha, the series moved to the PSP, without the involvement of Thomas all this time. None of the characters from 1 and 2 are here. Instead, you play as Takashi Sakamoto, who is a senior on the customary school trip to Kyoto. Actually, it's not Kyoto, but Kyoto. The game takes place over the 7 days of the school trip, and your objective is simply to find and beat up all the rival Bancho that are also there, because apparently every high school in Japan does their trip on the same week. To complete the game, you need to defeat all the Bancho from each prefecture of Japan, then face off against the Shinsengumi gang of Kyoto to become the ultimate Bancho. Doing this over the course of 7 days is almost impossible, but the game is designed to be able to be played many times over for completion. It doesn't even go to game over if you lose against the Shinsengumi leader like I did. There's no story here, not really. Sakamoto is just there to become the strongest. He also has a bit of an attitude problem, which is fitting, I suppose, but still, most of the enjoyment doesn't come from him, but from the Bancho. They range from typical tough guys to tough weirdos, and they can be a sight to behold. There's no open world anymore either, but there are a lot of areas in Kyoto to go to at least, and for me who actually lived there for a year, it was a trip in more than one way. Kenka Bancho 3 was also the only game in the whole series to get localized for the US, where it came out as Kenka Bancho Badass Rumble, published by, drumroll, Atlus. So you can guess how common it is on the secondhand market. Next up was a PSP port of the first game, then Kenka Bancho 4 Ichinen Senso. Tomozo was off doing Shinjuku no Okami when 3 was made, but he came back for game 4 as a writer, and it shows because this game is a lot better. The storyline is still about the same, tough kid wants to be the strongest, but the twist here is the comedy. The main character, Yuta Hayami, is confident. Really confident. Insanely confident. He shows up the first day of his first year in high school and wants to go straight to the senior Bancho and kick his ass. He's stopped by Teruo Chiba, the son of the information guy from the first 3 games actually. Chiba tells him that he can't just challenge him. First he has to work his way up by beating up all the other students and collecting their student badges. This process takes the entirety of Hayami's first year, which is what the title is about. There's barely a single conversation scene that isn't written humorously, and as we all know, fun is fun. Some characters from the first game even return, which is a treat for someone like me. Gameplay-wise, this is a simple polish of the previous game, and the movement is still a little slow, but because of the characters and their interactions, it's a good time. The best of the PSP games, in fact. Kenka Bancho 5 Otoko no Hosoku, or
Kenka Bancho 5 Otoko no Rule,
came next, and it's a solid one. The main character, Naoto Naruse, is a mix of Sakamoto and Hayami. He's not as wacky as Hayami, but not as serious and moody as Sakamoto. Naruse is a transfer student who, after taking over his own school, starts protecting them from outside threats. It's similar to the first game in that regard. In 4 you took student badges, here you make friends. To get more influence and proceed in the story, you have to take over areas by defeating everyone in that area and making them your friends. Keeping in mind that if you get lazy and skip the Menchi and Tanka process, they will refuse your friendship offer. Still no open world, but the areas are much bigger than usual, and even include the school from the previous game. And there are some big fights with a ton of enemies that are quite fun. After completion there's Take 2, where you can play the game from another perspective, and 6 shorter Gaiden-type stories with different characters. It's all good stuff, the only problem is that Tomozo didn't return as the writer, and it shows. The game tries to have a story, but it doesn't succeed in making me care about what's happening. And it's not nearly as funny either. Kenka Bancho Bros. Tokyo Battle Royale was the last game on PSP, and it goes back to the school trip concept of 3, except it's Tokyo now. Tokyo. You play as either of 2 characters, Kensuke or Kazuki, and they're not brothers, so I think the title wants you to read it as bros. This game streamlines everything to make it the most lightweight game in the series yet. Like 3, there's no story, just beating Bancho in Tokyo, and the interactions between the bros is only occasionally amusing. There are now no shops to go to in the world, they all reside in the menu. And you don't go from area to area anymore either, you just select them on the map and go where the Bancho are, that's it. Only, you have to beat up some of his followers first, then when the Bancho shows up, you have to go straight for them, as the small fry guys respawn infinitely. The upside though is that although the combat was never deep in the series, this one still probably has the best combat of the PSP games. The game ends at the Tokyo Skytree, where all the Bancho you defeated during the week return to get revenge on you. This leads to a battle that's much harder for completionists, but at least if you fail, you get experience and can try the mission again. I had to do it over maybe 6 times before I could beat all 40 Bancho, and I didn't even face all 43. Then the game pulls a double dragon on you, but by then it's really easy to only face one guy. This is also the only game to not do either load game or continue with punishment when you die. Here you just lose 1000 HP of your max and come back right there. You only lose the mission once you die with 1000 HP as your max, or when your buddy dies. After Bros, the series took a little hiatus, before coming back with Kenka Bancho 6 Soul and Blood, this time on the Nintendo 3DS, but without the 3D. Since 4, Tomozo had done Gachi Tora Abarembo Kyoshi in high school for Studio Zan, and they replaced the PSP developer Bullets for the 6th game. Kenka Bancho 6 is the first game since 2 to give story another serious go, with one that takes place over the span of 3 years, from enrollment to graduation, forcing my mind to draw parallels to Tokimeki Memorial. The main character is Daigo Asahina, who is an orphan with a chip on his shoulder. He doesn't give a damn and is always in a bad mood, leading his classmates to dislike him from the get-go. But we do find out that he's only so focused on getting money because he wants to help the orphanage he grew up in, saving it from getting shut down. He gets guidance from the older Super Bancho Ryuji Katagiri until he gets rammed by a car at the end of the first year and put in a coma. This one is the first since 2 to have voice acting. And it also has a manga presentation, complete with sound effect letters hanging in the air. The game is sped up quite a bit overall, which is nice, both in fights and when just running around. There's even a dash button. Just don't dash into a wall or something, that's not cool. Also, for some reason they removed the jump, so as a result there are no jump attacks anymore. Kenka Bancho 6 was the end of the series, at least that's where I stopped. There are 3 more games, but they're all visual novel otome games, all released on PlayStation Vita, and they were directed by Mana Ito. I haven't played them, but they star a girl who dresses up as a boy to find her twin brother, and while they are visual novels, Ito did try to implement some gameplay from the original series, which is commendable. There are some more elements that most, if not all, the games have in common. The otome games weren't the first Kenka Bancho games to have love in them, for instance. In the first game, you can gain one of 3 girls as a girlfriend, although Reina is the correct answer. Getting her can unlock the post-game storyline, where Tanaka goes to another town and Reina has to protect everyone in his absence, from the girlfriend of the ex-villain who now recruited an old foe to take you down. In the second game, the girlfriend character plays into the story in the way that if you go the evil route, you have to go along with kidnapping her at one point. And if you refuse, you basically start drifting back towards the good side again. In 3 to 5 there are potential girlfriends, although they're handled like side quests. And in 6 you can pick up girls or women on the street with a system that resembles the first 3 games' Tanka, and you can mix them up for fun results again too, although it's not as extensive. Out in the world you can pick up presents off the ground, which contain items and sometimes weapons. Weapons that you, of course, can't use, or you'll get uncool. An iron rule among Bancho, but a rule that the enemies ignore with glee. In 5, they even gave me a lightsaber at one point. I mean, what am I going to do? Not use it? The first 3 games' loading screens have a Bancho vocabulary to read while waiting. And from game 3 on, there are posters and graffiti you can stare at to gain more Tanka parts. For some, you need a sitting or charging stance other than the regular ones to reach. Every game in the series has the legends, a kind of achievement system. Once you fill the requirement, the game announces things like you being the man who united the Kyokuto and Shimamura schools for the first time in history, when you defeat the first boss. Some of these happen along the natural path of the story, but there are over 100 in total per game, and most of them have to do with completion aspects, and come with rewards like money and upgrade souls. In all of the games, if you become Shabai enough, you get a legend and a free banana suit. Every one of the PSP games, as well as 6 on 3DS, has a camera function where you can save a screenshot from any cutscene, and in 6, just whenever. Starting with Kenka Bancho 4, the series went after some of that sweet sponsorship money, and had Gyoza no Osho restaurants in the game, and shops like Tsuruya and Men's KBC that were references to Tsutaya and men's TBC respectively. But from 5 on, they would add Jean's Mate, Kamadoya, Asbi, and others. This sellout factor also reminds me of Yakuza, honestly. From 4 on, there were minigames, usually playable in the base save point. In 5, there was interestingly a game in the arcade, which is a fighting game version of Kenka Bancho 3. Most of the games also have side jobs for you to do to earn money, and on PSP, you can do them with a friend in a multiplayer mode. It's not exactly a minigame, maybe, but the fourth game has this athletics test, where all the classes go against each other in a sort of capture the flag meets battle royale type thing. And I bet you didn't expect this, but Kenka Bancho 6 has tests. At the end of each school year, you have to take a test to pass to the next. And sure, the English section is easy, but the algebra? Needless to say, I guessed my way through. The series doesn't have amazing cover art exactly. The first game overestimated its own CG quality, yet included an alternative front art which doesn't look great either. Most of the rest over-relied on the whole "let's just put all the characters on there" thing. It's not a style that I particularly enjoy, but I do enjoy the manuals, they're well done. The first one is written in Yankee speak, even the thank you for purchasing bit, which is always written in the politest Japanese otherwise. The in-game menus are also done quite well. 1 and 2 are just generally nice looking with black and red. The third game has Hanafuda, 4 has a notice board. 5 though is a bit odd, with the main guy thinking about stuff and making faces, but it's still inventive at the very least. The Kenka Bancho series also has distinctive music. The first two games has a more classic kind of Yankee soundtrack, with saxophones, flutes and guitars. The intro song is taken from the Battles Without Honor and Humanity series of 70s Yakuza movies, and the ending song is Otoko no Kunsho by Daisuke Shima from 1982. The rest of the soundtrack was done in part at least by Japanese music factory Dimension Crews. 3, 4, 5 and Bros had several people working on the soundtracks, but the main man was Iku Mizutani, who you might know worked at Natsume during the Famicom eras. There's still some old-school vibes to Kenka Bancho 3, but during Mizutani's tenure, the music gravitated more and more towards rock and metal music. Not that I'm complaining. He did a great job. The sixth game was done by Takuya Hanaoka, and while overall it might not be terribly different from Mizutani's music, the boss battles incorporated some heavy-sounding lyrics that I can't make out. The first four games were also adapted into movie form, released yearly between 2008 and 2011. They all seemed to follow the games closely, and they were all directed by Tsuyoshi Shoji. Now let me rank the series for you, although it's just my opinions, of course. The best game in the series is the second one, no question. The only one that had true depth and a complex villain. Having dual analog control and an almost completely open world also helps. The second best game is harder to decide, but I'm going to go with the fourth game, because it's funny. That means number 6 gets the third spot, the one with the next best storyline. But it doesn't do that much with its story really, so the funny fourth game narrowly won out. Then in fourth place comes the original Kenka Bancho. I'd say it represents the average for the series. In fifth place is the fifth game. It made some improvements over 3 and 4, but it didn't really try in the story department. Then there's the third game, which is pretty lightweight, but still nowhere near as lightweight as my bottom pick, Kenka Bancho Bros. The only game in the series that I don't really see myself playing through again. The Kenka Bancho series is one of those pleasant discoveries I've made since I began probing the depths of the world of Japan-only games. While I don't consider any of them great, even the best one I would rate maybe an 8 out of 10, they're still enjoyable beat-em-ups that serve as a kind of peer-through-the-keyhole look at a bizarre but fun world of Yankee boys, who won't hesitate to beat you up, but only if you stare at and insult them first.
Cruise me.